Just over the last couple of years, in the academic laboratories worldwide, a new technology was developed. And this new technology is called quantum technology. It comes with a promise to make our secrets in the internet communication secret again, this time protected by a law of physics. And we all know that in a connected world and in the digital area, internet communications and the privacy secrecy of internet communication is really, really important. Just think about autonomous cars, flights, power plants, everything is connected, everything is digitized, and this is an asset, and we have to make sure that this is really, really secure. And I'm talking about quantum physics here, and everyone in the room will say now, oh, that's weird, that's new, this is counterintuitive, I don't want to hear, I don't want to understand. But I tell you, you have to admit that it is also hard to understand why an Airbus A330 takes flight. It can seat almost 1,000 passengers. Its weight is 500 tons, it can cross the Atlantic, cross Asia, goes from Europe to China and Japan. So I think there is no one out there who really understands that this giant machine can fly. So why do we sit into such a machine, and why do we trust that we survive? It is because we have a personal sensory experience to that it works. The machine just works. The same is true for the device you all have in your hand, and you use that many, many times already today. It is very hard to understand all the movements of the electrons in the semiconductor crystals, which are in this device. And the digital era is the result of an amazing research done in this direction. So we don't understand Airbuses, we don't understand our mobiles, but we do it because we have our sensory experience with that. And now I want to tell you a story how I came to use quantum physics in the lab. It was many, many years ago when I started my experiments in the lab. I was left alone by my supervisors in the lab, and I played around aligning a quantum source. This is a source which produces quantum states. And that's the basis of the new technology I'm gonna explain to you. So, and this involves a laser, and the laser is emitting light, and the light is made out of little particles. These basic particles of light are called photons. So we at that time, these quantum states were produced using a laser, a crystal, and this crystal creates two photons, these little quantum states, and they go to the detector on one side and then one detector to the other side. So these detectors will click simultaneously, because these photons are emitted by the crystal and hit the detector at the time. So this is still the procedure we use today, and it is today amazingly efficient, so we can do it many, many million times a second, but at that time this was only a few hundreds per second. And then we put polarizers in, and then I started an experiment. I started an experiment as a young student, not so much as an adult researcher looking for, you know, knowledge and to gain know-how about the basic principles of nature. So it was more like a child hoping for serendipity. So I really couldn't make my understanding around how this works. And we experimental physicists, when we go into the lab, we ask questions. We ask questions to nature, and nature answers. And here it's an interesting situation. So we put polarizers in, and this polarizer measures a property of this single photon, and this property is called, guess what, polarization. So in the end, it's a very simple experiment. I put a polarizer in one arm, and I put a polarizer in the second arm. And I played around for a long time, and I found somehow out that if I put the polarizer on one side in a certain direction, all the photons on the second side will be also in this same polarization. I thought this makes sense. the photon, where it's created, the crystal just produces these two kinds of photons. So then I switched the polarizer on one side, and I found no clicks anymore, until I switched the polarization on the second side. And I had a lot of clicks again. So I thought that's maybe also makes sense, because the crystal maybe randomly produces these two kinds of photons only, and send it randomly in these two directions. So I somehow can make sense out of that, I can understand it. But then I asked different kinds of questions. Namely, I put a polarizer to a diagonal angle, and I found out the photons will be also diagonal on the second side. I can even switch these polarizers while these photons are on their way from the crystals to the polarizers. So the photon cannot know what it will be measured, how it will be measured when it gets to the polarizer. So if I measure one photon here, the other one will also be here. Not here, not here, not here. It will be that one. The same is true for all polarizations, all kinds of polarizations. It turned out that these photons are always polarized the same way. So they are always the same. They will be never different. So if you make a little table, you can see that if I look on this polarization, and if I look at this polarization, I have a lot of clicks, but I do it differently on both sides, I see no clicks whatsoever. So the question is, if I put a polarizer on one side here, how does the second photon know what it is gonna measure it in? What property has the second photon prior to the measurement? Isn't it the case that everything out there, even an Airbus A380, has a flight height of like 10 kilometers, independent if someone measures its height? It has a dimension independent of its height. But the photon in this special case doesn't have a property. It can be revealed to be like everything. I can force the second photon with the first photon to be in every polarization without touching at it. So we call that feature of quantum physics non-locality. So the photon has mutually exclusive states on the second side. So it is either horizontal or vertical. It's like a little cat being dead and alive at the same time. So it is vertical and horizontal, and I can make it to be revealed in the one state or the other. So it's very hard to make a picture out of that. So this is the Schrödinger's cat, which is half dead and alive. So this was invented by the Austrian physicist Erwin Schrödinger. And this somehow tells you that there's something out there in nature, built into nature, and only if I do the measurement of the polarization, it really gets a polarization. Without that, it doesn't have a polarization. This is what I discovered with my own hands, with my own little serendipity experiment in the lab. So I thought this is really something new. This is something which is, I haven't seen that out there. Everywhere. Our normal computer age is made out of digits, right? It's a logical one and a logical zero. So our whole life, our whole philosophical structure is made of being there or being not there. So there's nothing in between. We, in quantum physics, we believe these quantum states, they are very rich in a sense, so they can reveal themselves as like everything. It's not like just being zero or one, like the basic building blocks in a computer. But once you measure it, once you send it through a polarizer, the photon has to decide, am I going through, am I not going through? So that's a random process, but after that, it's just a very boring classical computer state. It's just zero and one. We just took the richness away because we know the polarization. Before the polarizer, we don't know the polarization. In this sense, a quantum state is very, very rich. The question is, how does that happen? How does nature do that? So is there a communication from one side to the other? We found out this is impossible because we can switch these polarizers very, very fast. So even when the photon is on its way, there is no way that it tells the other photon, look, when I go through, can you please also go through? There's no way, because the speed of light is the limit, as we all know. So this is not how nature is doing that. So the whole structure of the universe at the quantum level seems to look different. This is subjected to research nowadays. This is really something people look into it, and it is far from being understood. But we can work with it. These two photons behave as they would be one. One of them just goes randomly through the polarizer or not, but if you look at both of them, you see a correlated randomness. So these two photons, they stay entangled, and that's the term we use in science, they stay entangled over very long distances. Albert Einstein, who was not a fan of quantum physics, called that spooky action at a distance. You have to admit that this is now intellectually very different from understanding an Airbus, because in the Airbus, we all know that a paper airplane can fly. We all throw a stone into a river, so we know things can fly. And an Airbus is just too big to understand. So this is a question of scaling. But quantum physics, it's different. It's the basic building blocks of our nature, surrounding nature, is behaving differently. So when I can influence the one photon and the other one behaves the same way, can I use it for communication? Can I connect people with that? The answer is unfortunately not, because this is a random process. And when I do a measurement on one side, the other guy has a one-time chance to measure the polarization. So he has to have the polarizer in the right angle to see the correct result. So there is no way to communicate with such a system, because in communication you ultimately want to influence what you send. But they get random results on both sides. And the question is there a task out there we can use for communication, which is somehow useful? And remember what I just said a few minutes ago. The photon states were very, very rich before they got to the polarizers. After the polarizers, it's a boring classical state. So all these correlations, and we prove all these correlations, are you still the same or are you different? If you are the same, then the photon was not hitting a polarizer before us. So there was no measurement taking place. We can see if someone measured before us. And this is new. This is new. In a classical internet, we all know we can copy messages many, many times. We don't change it. If you send an email around the globe, you never know how many people have read it. But here, they lose the correlation. These quantum states are so tiny and weak. We can see if someone measured. We can see if someone tried to hack. And this was the starting day in 1991 by Arthur Eckert. He invented a protocol. He's a researcher, renowned researcher from the UK, which deals with communication cryptography. And this is a task in telecommunication which is really important. What you need for that is a randomness. You have a message on one side, you want to encrypt the message, and you want to read it on the other side. And you use this randomness, which comes from these entangled photons, because they show the same result. Underway, there is no information whatsoever. This Schrödinger kite is just traveling, the hacker can measure it, he cannot get any information out of that. But we can prove if they still correlated, and if they are correlated, we can, with the same randomness, with this string of bits, encrypt the message, we send it over a public channel, you can publish it in the newspaper, nobody can read it, you give it to the receiver of the encrypted message, he will use the same randomness, the same bit of the string of bits, of random bits, to decrypt the message. And this is a new business case, and this is called quantum cryptography. Many people do this research nowadays. There is an experiment just last year done by our Chinese colleagues who distributed entangled photons, and this is really, in the end, the same device I was using many, many years ago. On that satellite, sent down single photons from the satellite to the ground, and then these two receivers on ground could encrypt a message. So this these technologies out there. And this is just one example of a business case which is growing right now. We all know that quantum computers are on the horizon. They are much more difficult to implement, so this will need a little longer to reach the maturity of our normal all-day computers. And those quantum computers are able to decrypt a classical message. So on the one hand, they are helping to marketize, to commercialize quantum key distribution system. And this research was dominated by the European community, by the European taxpayers. So we as a European society, quantum research society was supported a lot by the taxpayers, and we believe we should also commercialize this now here to make the added value here, to make the jobs, to create the jobs here, and not in some other valley again somewhere else. But we believe it's time to make an Alpine Valley. Remember, this all happened at many, many laboratories worldwide. This came out of serendipity experiments. This came out of academic laboratories. So the basic research was the source for this new kind of technology. And this quantum technology will now change our world a bit, in the sense that we can encrypt messages and we can make them very secret. We can use quantum computers. They are very efficient in certain tasks. So I hope I convinced you that a modern digital era and a modern era where we use autonomous car without quantum safe communication is impossible. So I believe quantum physics is not weird. It is solving the problems we have today. The future is quantum. Thank you.